So, hello. It is time to take a look back and see what can be improved on the formula. As it's known, the Steelbourne Royale it had its last round last week, and this week I'm going to talk a bit about what worked, what didn't work, especially what didn't work, because there are a few, and a fair amount of that is due to yours truly, me. So let's get to it then, shall we? This will both be what can be improved on the formula and how the underlying system in a way needs the proper campaign to function. The system that have been used is the faction turn from Stars Without Numbers revised edition, pretty much straight off. Those pages taken from the book, lifted out, and it kind of fell slightly flat, because those rules need the adventuring party to shake things up, to drive the narrative a bit more. The faction turn, after all, it's just a tool for the GM to manage the sector. So, what can really be said about the first season in hindsight? It became a passive and economic-focused game. I'm not saying that's a bad game, but it wasn't really what I had hoped for. I were hoping for a bit more conflict in it, because in many ways conflict is bad. Conflict drives narratives, and that's what I was interested in getting. As I said, it was a relatively peaceful game. Just a few aggressive actions. I will talk more about why I think that happened. And then there was the issue that I felt that every turn was so small many times. You buy an asset, then that's the turn. And while it's not feasible to have more turns per week to speed up the game that way, the other way is to increase the turn to speed up the game that way, to make more things happen each round. Onto the problems then. The first one. The players, they started way too spread out. That it was my fault entirely. I didn't really know what the game required. These spread out starting positions also led that there were plenty of free space to be conquered. So why don't we take a look at the sector, actually how it started. These five systems. Oh, I forgot to mark one of them. Let's see, Helix Foundation. No. As we see, the factions, they are spread out. Players are a bit all over the map. And you see all these free systems to be conquered before there even is any space issues. And with the game being in the end that slow, it meant that the players had no reason to butt heads. They had no reason to get aggressive. So, but I do have a solution for this, and it's, to be honest, a quite simple solution. I'm simply going to shorten the distances between the starting positions. I'm debating both shared systems or neighboring systems. At least neighboring systems, so that there isn't any space between them. For example, the Bountiful Trade Conglomerate and the Helix Foundation. Those two starting positions are neighboring. And that is the maximum distance between two factions I'm going to have. Sure, then there can be a third faction there and fourth there. But so that they have at least one neighbor directly to them. But this wasn't the only problem. The second one was the focus on economic expansion. And I believe that was in part because the players could grow their faction safely and peacefully. Again, they could amass power without having to butt heads with another player. Again, all that free real estate. Yes, they're therefore conquering. So, this is slightly more difficult to solve, as building economy is a good strategy. It's a valid strategy. I want it to be a valid strategy, but not the dominant one. The first one is to start with the faction's assets closer to the supply limit. That they in a way already have built up their economic base even before the game starts. So instead of there being 10-15 turns of building, they start out already built. Also, if the factions are closer to their supply limit, they cannot build that much without having supply issues. So, which then means that they will need to do something to either get rid of assets or find a way to increase their supply limit. I will talk about that later as well. But yeah, as I said, the idea is to have each faction's economic base already built up, or their military might, but then once they lose a few assets again, then the economy kicks in. And also to offer greater rewards for risky endeavors. That one is a bit more tricky to implement and will probably need fair bit of fine tuning. Yeah, there are some ideas I have around it, but that one is something that is in the relatively early part of my thought process. The third problem, a lack of direction. I did put the players in a sandbox, and they were made the masters of it. The sandbox couldn't touch them. Only other players could touch them. The sector and all the lovely things in it was just background. It was just there. It didn't do anything. Passive, static. That wasn't that very good, to be honest. Then there was also a slight issue that I just started the game, and then it was I'll figure out somehow to define victory terms later on. And I believe I would have needed those victory terms already when I started. So I have already talked a bit about the solutions. But the first solution is to introduce random events. I kind of personally hate random events. It's more, but that is actually what they're going to be, because I want the sector to be a neutral force, that the dice decides how it reacts. These random events, I have ideas from, for example, a derelict spaceship have been discovered somewhere. The first one or the one that holds it on the third turn after the first asset was put there, have managed to repair it and take control of it, and then gain that asset. That sounded a bit complicated. Well, the idea is that you move an asset set somewhere, everyone races to it, you get there, you hold it for a few rounds, and then you get it. Or just the first one who gets it. Other random events, I have ideas of how they spawn from the planetary tags. Let's hop over to the sector. For example, let's bring up planet Horondi. They got sectarians and they got a trade hub. This trade hub, that is I can define that tag as a wealth tag. And then, for example, I rolled, for example, that something happens to wealth tags this round, and then I roll on the wealth tag table. And then I get, for example, trade hub. So then all the worlds which have a trade hub, those that have a base of influence on it gain an additional free income per round, making it quite lucrative to maintain that base of influence. And it would also be a good strategy to knock out or perhaps just contest the base of influence of your opponent to deny them that income. There are plenty other ideas I have of it. I've also thought about giving worlds mechanical bonuses to their controller. For example, a world provides plus one supply limit or plus one income. Again, that is a bit... I'm not sure about that. I'm going to talk about it a bit more later on. But that's one idea to give the players a sense of direction and goals. Speaking of goals. Clear victory objectives. For example, holding a system or just a world on that system. each round, a victory point is awarded, and upon a certain number of victory points, that faction wins that season. And have several of these victory objectives scattered in the sector, in such a way that they promote conflict. This way, the factions have to contest them if they want to win. Sure, if they just want to play and have a nice time, they don't have to bother with it. And a closely related problem to the previous one is that the faction turn needs the proper campaign. When the game started, the factions had no history. They had no connection to the sector. They had no cultural home world. They had no connection to anything, not even to each other. There were some relationships being built, but all of this happened during game. How important this is, I'm not entirely sure of. But if the factions have a history, and history with each other, perhaps a certain some rivalries can already be there from the start, and a bit more banter can be developed. Then, as I said in the introduction, the faction turn is lifted from the starts with that number system and isolated from the rest. And it originally meant as a tool for the game master to run the sector, to have it dynamic. But never a focus of a game. That would be the adventuring party. And the faction turn needs the adventure party in a way. To have the adventuring party stir up trouble. To cause opportunities. One can, for example, see this in the far Verona faction turn, where there are these where the factions they have relationships with the player characters, and what happens in the campaign game have that connects to the faction game, and the faction game connects back to the campaign. However, there was nothing of that here, nothing at all. So that makes it that made the sector itself flat. So, but there are a few solutions to this. The first one is to find a way to build the history of the sector together with the players, so that there are reasons for the faction's existence and their initial relations. This is a tricky one, because I don't really know how to do this in a smooth way without sitting down with everyone. And if there are many players for season 2, it may be too many chefs. So something that for example, a bunch of events can be rolled, and then the players get to insert a faction in these events. Now that I think of it, The latest rune quest, Glorantha, has a part in the character creation where you connect your family's history to the region's events. Really nice, and I'll write up sector history with the sector events, and then each player can tell what their faction did during that event, and perhaps with what other factions they cooperated with and was against. I am so going to make a note of that. Sometimes a genius strokes when you least expect it. And the other solution to it, the other part of this problem, is to simulate an adventuring party, which again would tie back to random events, which would be an abstraction for this adventuring party. Playing a game to do this is unfeasible, as you can have a bunch of one-shots, short missions that each take place once per round, that connects to what happened the previous round, that will give context to the next round. Or simply just abstract it through random events. As, for example, what I said with the trade hub planet. Perhaps the players disrupted commerce. As in, that tag no longer... So that tag becomes ineffective for a certain number of rounds. Until the economy stabilizes. The fourth problem is the highly mechanical one, the small turn. I have gotten the suggestions to have multiple turns each week. I don't want to do that, as that would be way too time sensitive. A player would then get one day, 24 hours, between to do their turn, to react if they're being attacked and so on, which would force a player to be online on a certain day. I don't want that. I want to lower the barrier of entrance as much as possible. Currently it is 48 hours, 2 days. That is much more doable. So that you can forget it one day and then realize that you forgot it. So instead, the other solution is to increase the volume of the turn, the turn's mass, the importance of each turn. So, for example, open up for multiple actions per turn, so that instead of the action being purchase an asset, you can now purchase an asset and use asset abilities. Wonderful. Now things will happen. It will probably cause a lot of issues. So, for example, Paul, what if you double up on use asset abilities, double up on an attack? So, it would be with limitations. Such as you cannot take the same action twice in a row. I've also been thinking about that the same asset cannot be used twice per turn with some clarifications. For example, if another asset uses that asset, for example, a transport network, can that moves an asset, then that makes the asset transported a passive part. However, that will get into even more details, and when is an asset a passive and when is it not. So there may be a limitation that the same asset cannot be involved in two actions. It cannot be involved in both actions each round. And it's a solution I think will be good for the game, because once you can start to, because then it will technically be two turns per week, except that it will happen that there will only be one resolution round, and that will make it also go a bit faster. Instead of, as I said, purchasing a single asset around. For its original intent of the faction turn, that would be probably all that is needed. But not for what I'm desiring. And that are the major issues that I had discovered during season one. That to repeat them, that players were too spread out. There were no reason to get in conflict with anyone. Which led into the second problem, that it became a passive economy building game, because there were no reason to get into conflict with each other. Which also may be because there was a lack of direction for the game, no victory conditions, every system being the same. Sure, there was one tech level 5 world, I believe, but that never got used. So this lack of direction also meant that the players didn't have to get into conflict with each other to be able to win. And the fourth problem was that the turns were small. They were sometimes nothing really happened. I did have resolution turns where it was purchase of assets. It was done quick, do done. So what do I plan for season 2 then? Well, to put it in a bit more compact format. Yeah, the players are going to start much closer. As I said, shared a neighboring system. The number of starting assets closer to their supply limit. To make sure that they already have an economic base built or a military base, depending on what they want to do. Larger turns to to contain these double actions, so that more can happen each round, and instead of having 10 passive turns, it would only be 5 passive turns, because they can use asset ability, purchase asset in the same turn, instead of having 2 turns spread over 2 rounds. Clear victory conditions, control points, king of the hill variant, where the one that is in control of it gained the point. Perhaps a smaller amount of points to the runner up. Some worlds with mechanical bonuses to their controller. As I said, perhaps a world gives a +1 supply limit, or a plus 3 income, or or perhaps it will act as a tech level 5 world for cunning assets, and so on. And then to introduce random events that changes up the static sector. From a simulated adventuring party causing trouble to the sector reacting to what the factions are doing. If, for example, all the factions are hoarding resources, perhaps the trade hubs become stagnant and they no longer give any economic benefit. Or perhaps there is large scale conflict and those with post-tech industries or industries in general get +1 income per industry they have, since they can jack up prices. Things like this. Then there was the sector and faction history, and the idea I got to do like a rune quest Gloranta. I'm actually going to see if I can put up that. Let's see, where do I have it? So let's see, it wasn't in that folder. So found it finally. So here is how the family history work in RuneQuest Gloranfa. It states that in the year 1561, the player character's grandparents were born, and then you choose the important grandparent, and you will follow this important grandparent for a while, so that in the year 1582. King Tarkalar and his wife, the Feathered Horse Queen, went to war with the Lunar Empire to aid all the Tarshites, aided by Praxian and Asrolian mercenaries and volunteers, blah 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 blah. So, and then there are these year 1582 events. So, and then you take a d20, roll it, and then you look up what happened. So, let's say that we rolled a 5. Your grandparent, no, we rolled a 15. Your grandparent was present at the Battle of Grizzly Peak. Wow, something happened to your grandparent. To translate this to the faction game is that in that year there was a major conflict. Your faction was involved in that was about something. What was your faction's involvement? Roll or choose. And then, for example, faction was involved, faction was not involved. So, and then you go and take a look into it, as here, the Battle of Grizzly Peak. The grandparent survived. If a Sartrite or a Lunar Tarshite continue to Battle of Aldashur, those homelands, they were involved in the Battle of Aldashur. So then you go to there. And then there are other options. Such a thing will take a bit of time to figure out. But perhaps there are things I can use. Perhaps there doesn't need to be page upon page upon page upon page upon page. We are still not done. Yeah, so perhaps 5-6 of these events, and then that will create faction history within the sector history. I'm getting more and more hyped for that. Then there is a thing I haven't noticed. I want to increase the importance of bases of influence. For example, that they can get the supply limit bonuses, income bonuses, power projection bonuses. For that I mean that the allied forces within 1 hex of that base of influence get +1 to their rolls. And perhaps divided into cunning, force, wealth. But to be honest, if you're a wealth faction, your best assets will be wealth assets. And you will pick up some complementary assets from the other categories, but you will depend on wealth. So perhaps there is not needed. Perhaps it's not needed to divide it further. So that is what I intend to do. I will make a... There will come a proper write-up of this as a suggested rule set for Season 2. But there is more. These world bonuses and random events, I need to talk about those more. For world bonuses, I want to divide that up into temporary and permanent effects. Temporary is, for example, like that the trade hub is booming, or granting more income. These will be randomly rolled. I don't want to handpick that. Then also permanent effects. These will be put into to the game with care and precision. So that, for example, as I said, victory point worlds. worlds that statically give a bonus for to, for example, supply limit. And these, as I said, handcrafted, put at specific locations, will probably be some sort of symmetry. For the temporary effects, these will be based on the tags. And these tags will, first of all, I have to go through them all, divide them into various categories. The five easily thought of are force tags, cunning tags, and wealth tags. And generic advantageous tags and generic detrimental tags. We can actually go and take a look at a few of the tags. So, and let's see, sector creation, world tags. Battleground. This world is a battleground for two or more outside powers. They may be interstellar rivals or groups operating out of orbitals or other system bodies. Something about the planet is valuable enough for them to fight over, but the natives are too weak to be anything but animate obstacles to the fight. A world with such a tag would be detrimental, for example. Badlands world would also be a detrimental tag. Heavy mining. This world has large stocks of valuable minerals, usually necessary for local industry, etc., etc. That is a wealth tag. So, heavy industry, the same. So, for example, let's say I roll on the table for now, and get that wealth tags are to be boosted. Then I do a number of other rolls on the wealth tag table, and then let's say I get heavy mining. So then for the next three rounds, all the worlds with heavy mining, they give an income of, let's say, three extra fact credits per turn. Yeah, something that that will make these worlds attractive to go after. There will also be a strategy to claim worlds with beneficial tags. For example, a world with both heavy industry and heavy mining. Yeah, that would be a good strategic choice to hope that the industry get a surge. Because then you are already there and you can soak up all the fact creds it produces. For random events, these would be, as I said, temporary. Both these that connects to the world tags, but also that special events that happens with the rewards such as take level 5 assets, free rerolls that can be used to reroll any role according to certain specifications. For example, you can say that your commodities brokers will use this reroll if they roll a 1, thus most likely saving them. Or if you are attacking, you can say that the first missed attacker is going to use the reroll. Such things that makes it valuable to to go after them. And then finally I have a few thoughts about how to actually handle the sector. Last round I rolled it randomly. Again, let's hop back to the sector. If you notice, all the starting positions are within the third to the seventh. You see, since they start on zero, the second planet, if the coordinate is 0, 0, 2, that is on the third spot. 1, 2, 3. So that. So what I did was that I generated a sector, a 10x10 sector. Then I rolled randomly for the player's starting positions, within this inner square, this 3 to 7 square. And as you can see, they ended up in a certain pattern here. Some were far away from everyone else, others were a bit closer. For next round, I'm going to hand pick starting positions. But then which faction that gets each system, that will be random. But not the layout of the system. I will also create the core systems, the victory conditions and such things, to have a somewhat fair playing ground. There will still be some randomness to it. Then outside this core part of the sector, I will randomly scatter worlds. Just to toss them out there, roll up a certain number of planets in them, and give the planets some tags. These unknown worlds, their tags may be hidden until. Until the first unit arrives and explores that world. But I can also see the point in having it open so that directed colonization can be made. So not just explore randomly and hoping you hit the gold mine, but you know where the gold mines are and you can compete for them. Then I have a nice little idea for black holes. I'm thinking of turning these into wormholes instead, such that when an asset moves upon the wormhole, they are instantly transported to the other side and can continue their movements from there. So, for example, let's go back to the sector, because that's just more convenient. For example, this black hole here at 0807, that may be connected to 0207. So, let's say you have a transport network on 0707 that transports the unit to the black hole. It pops out of the black hole and then it can continue its movement. However, the return journey will be impossible the same way, because the transport network is still over here. And the transport network can transport someone to the other side of the black hole, but not back from it. then there is also the question of how are these black holes connected? Are they between fixed points so that one black hole only leads to another black hole, which is how it is generally in fiction. But I can definitely see a reason for them to be all connected through a wormhole space. Completely pseudoscience and probably absolutely not working, but hey, it's science fiction. Fiction. So if I do this, I'm definitely leaning towards free exit. So this means that from there you can pop up there, you can pop up there, and if I am going to and if there were more black holes, you can pop up at some other position. Again, these black holes can be hand placed. Some will probably be and then some scattered. If they are free travel, they provide excellent backdoors into for surprise visits. And that is pretty much all that I had to talk about. There will be some changes to the next round. There will be some new things. And it will hopefully be a better game of it. The way I'm thinking when I just think of these hacks and changes is that I want to promote conflict. Conflict between the players, so that sitting back and being passive, that doesn't net you the win. That perhaps you are even distanced by factions that take risks. And basically everything will be about that. The to promote risk taking, to promote aggressivity, to promote conflict. Because in these fictional games, conflict is fun. Conflict drives narrative, and from the narrative we get a story. We get a tale of, for example, the Flaming Dragon's horrible blockade, and that point, and at that time when the Bountiful Trade Conglomerate, I believe it was, lost their commodities broker. It made some horrible, horrible deals and went up in smoke. That is what I want to get out of season two. A nice conflict-filled narrative. And that's all I had for this evening. So whenever you pick this up, I hope you enjoy the changes I'm going to make. If they sound completely bollocks, let me know and we'll discuss it. And if you want to join for season two, well, just keep a lookout for the announcement. And if you are someone that is from outside of the Steelbourne Legion, There is a link below where you, that will take you to the Legion's little place on the internet. Toss in an application and then take a look out for the announcement. And I hope I'll see you in the next Steelbourne Royale with extra cheese. Because lactose intolerance. See you there.